Welcome to another teardown and test video. This time it's a battery charger. Okay, it says that I can only use this battery charger for Duracell nickel metal hydride, and I can only use it with the correct adapter, but they're friendly enough to say that I need 12 volts with a minimum capability of 1.5 amps. They also say that they charge each AA cell with 2 amps to 1.4 volts, so that is nearly 3 watts of total power per cell. And this is how it looks. And this is an AA mode. There is a mode switch here on the side. And the cool thing about the mode switch is that, of course, there must be some electrical things inside, but when you switch this, then this part comes down and then it fits AAA cells perfectly fine. So it's funny to see all the stuff that comes in for testing and teardown. I don't have the original charger, and I don't have the original cells, I'm sorry about that. But anyway, first I would like to see that if this thing actually works, or if it doesn't work. So, let's try and see if we can connect this. Alright, so now it's connected 12 volts and 0.4 watts of idle. And it is looking like it is alive, because the current is fluctuating a little bit, and this reveals that this thing is actually doing something. If I take a voltmeter and measure here, I see 3 to 5 volts also fluctuating. So it's looking for cells. So there's something in here that is alive. I just took some random cells. I know they're more or less half full. So if I stick one in, I get an LED, and I get 5 watts, 3 to 5 watts. It's fluctuating, you see? So it's testing the cell's internal resistance or something like that. So it is the watts that we are looking for, because I'm not measuring the charge current on each cell. But this will reveal that it's actually charging more than 2 amps into this cell. Let's try and put on one more and see if it goes up. Oh yeah! So that is 8 or 6, 7, see? So it's pulsing something. Let's just put in 2 more. See what happens. So they all go solid because it is charging, and now we have 10 to 14 in pulses, but most of the time 14.6 or something like that. So this is the average. So again, this revealed that we're charging at really, really high power per cell. So, what I think is, this thing actually works. So, what we're going to do now is, what is inside? Let's tear this thing down. Let's disconnect. And let's open. That is what we like to do. So that was really easy. 4 Torx 8. I'm a little bit curious about this mechanic things here. Is this going to fall apart? Ooh, there is a lot more than expected. And what the heck is that? Wow, that is a lot of high current optimization. So there's a field effect transistor here running at insane current. What the heck is that? A thick layer of solder to give it current capabilities. Ha! Have you seen that before? Let's see if we can see the IC. Yeah, it's a 494. A classic switch mode controller. Looks like there's a little bit of water damage or something. Maybe I should try and clean this up a little bit. And there's a big microcontroller here. What is that doing? So this is for measuring each of the cells, different voltages. Look at those different. Aha, so those are the return wires, individual to each cell, and the positive to each cell. Wow, it's really complicated. I didn't expect it to be. Aha. So those are the flexible positive. And what have we down here? Because I was a little bit worried about. What is that? This little piece of metal that is around the cells. I had an idea that could be a temperature probe of some sort. But what the heck is that? So we've got two wires going to. Maybe that is what it is. Let me try and poke this open and see what it is. So those kind of sticks when I tried to pull this out. That was difficult. And a lot of glue and just break this and break that. So this is how you open it. But look at that. It is individual temperature sensors. Have you seen that before? So they intended to add a little bit of heat transfer compound. But they didn't really do it right, so they just don't touch anywhere. They try to dippity-dip a little bit, but come on, that didn't work. So that's the different. Ah, this is really, really funny. Okay. Temperature sensing. Fantastic. And then all the high power leads from each cell. Let's have a look at the positive side. Can we just, yes, we can. Oh, I need two hands. Okay, we are in. This is a lot more complicated than I actually imagined. Look, see when I'm operating the triple A. All this front piece move up and down, but it also activate this little switch. Yeah. So the hardware and software and whatever knows to crank down the charge current a little bit. Isn't this just amazing? That much electronics? And the individual field effect transistors. And what is that? Those are double FETs. Wow. It is really, really crazy. It is that complicated. And here is the CPU. That is doing a lot of measurement and controlling of all the positives and negatives and what have you not. Wow. I must say that I didn't expect it to be that complicated. So we have 12 volt going in. So this is of course, okay, so there's a little LM317 for the local supply. There's a trimmer. Oh, come on, let's have a look. What else have we got? A lot of tiny transistors and resistors and all sorts of stuff. So those diodes, is that it? Who is doing 4 times 2 amps? I would like to see that. So this is just the inductor cranking down the 12 volts. So this is probably the, yeah, look at that. So this is the positive input. And then this FET 4453A. So this is a normal NFET, right? In series is with the positive, and this positive, and here's a diode. So this is a normal step down, a normal buck. Back to ground. Yep, back to ground, of course. Yeah. So that is what we got. So this is a buck converter making low voltage, but high current. Fascinating. This is just, I didn't really expect it to be that complicated and that crazy. It's just full of all sorts of fantastic things. And a resonator running at 8 megahertz. Yeah, but this is actually working. Maybe I should just put it back together and just use it to blow up some batteries or something. But I'm not impressed with the individual temperature sensors that is just barely touching here, and there's not enough heat transfer. This heat transfer thing is not really so genius. But I bet it's better than doing absolutely nothing. So if there is a temperature rise, a cell is about to blow up or something bad is going on, obviously it's going to detect it and shut down this supercharge cycle. And this way we're going to save our homes. But that's how it is. All right, that was a super fast one. Hope you had fun. See ya. Bye bye.